got a door. Somebody's got a house, some. Looks like he's enjoying himself.
Listen to the sound of my hand clapping.
This guy had the blues. Stick him up and give me all your joy.
Joy?
Yeah, ever heard of the word?
Joy is just a state of mind.
State of mind.
Just getting in touch with the cosmos.
The cosmos.
The stars.
Stars.
Drugs.
Get out of here, you
My name's Tim Workington, and I'm from Glenora, Manitoba.
Yay, again.
David Hallman, I'm from St. Helens, Alberta. And right now I'm just going to share with you a bit of my testimony.
What was the best year of your life, do you think?
The best year of my life? I don't know. I got a lot of good years in my life. This is a fun picture, but you don't want it in the album because they washed their long johns and hung them on the outdoor line, and that's a frozen pair of
frozen pair of underwear. Yeah. Smile for the camera. Can you do a thumbs up?
Not really. This is about as good as I can do.
That's our thumbs up.
This is, to my knowledge, the last photo taken of me before the fire. That's my older brother Kyer. That's my older sister, Kimberly, but she actually did not survive the fire.
So when I was 5 years old, my family was living in St. Albert, and we got to know the next door neighbors pretty well. And one night, the next door neighbors invited us over to sleep in their tent that they'd set up in the backyard. And they invited my brother and sister and I over. And during the night, while we were sleeping, some teenagers came by. I thought they'd play a joke, so they threw some firecrackers in the tent. But the firecrackers didn't go off.
So what the police determined, they burned holes in the tent with their cigarettes and lit the firecrackers and slid them into the tent. And something in the tent, probably a sleeping bag or something, caught on fire. And the tent was collapsed, and everybody in the tent was engulfed in fire, and the neighbor's daughter got out first with minor burns, and then the neighbor's dad jumped into the fire and picked up my older brother and threw him out of the tent onto the grass. And then he looked down into the fire and he spotted me and he picked me up and carried me out. And
I was rushed to the hospital that night with second and third degree burns. And my older brother had first and second degree burns, and my sister didn't make it.
And the doctor there did not think that I'd survive the night, so he kind of did what he could, and I was burned 60% of my body, which is basically my whole upper torso, so belly button up, and my neck and arms and back and head. So from what I was able to find out, there were three boys that started the fire, age 12 and 13, and I was 5 at the time. So they were quite a bit older than me and way ahead of me in school, so I never actually met them. And when I was writing my autobiography, I did reach out to one of them, and I'd always heard that he'd always felt bad about what had happened. And so I found him on social media, and I messaged him to see if he'd be willing to sit down and talk about the night of the fire. But he never responded to that. I just think he felt bad enough about it that he'd feel worse if he sat down with me and saw what had happened to me. So no, I never got to talk to them, and I did make a conscious choice, because with the help of Jesus in my heart, I was able to forgive them. And I don't really think about them much anymore these days. So people often ask me, you know, how is it you can do this stuff with your hands? Because they look so much different than other people's hands, and so they don't comprehend how you can do anything. And what I like to tell them is, if you practice something every day for years, you'll get good at it. In fact, you know, I was learned at age 5, and by 18, you know, I could beat a lot of people at shooting games in basketball. So in my 20s, people would often think that I had a mental disability just because of my physical appearance, when the truth of the matter is that I was a straight A student in high school, and I was a solid B student in university. Then that cat went right in. Insouciance, lack of concern, nonchalance. I think reading when I was in the hospital was a great escape from what was happening around me. And then reading after I got out of the hospital became a great escape from life itself. And then I just loved reading, so I just kept on reading. I wrote my first novel, kind of a lighthearted mystery adventure. Check me out at booksbydave.com in June, and that book will pop up when it's available. So in the hospital, shortly after the fire, when it looked like I wasn't going to live, I wasn't going to make it, one of the hospital staff tried to maybe break that news to my mom a little, make it a little easier by, you know, telling her maybe it wasn't a bad thing that I go, because otherwise I'd be totally dependent upon my parents for the rest of my life. And that's when I was 5. I actually left home 11 years later, and I'm totally independent now. What I've learned about life is that you can choose to have a positive attitude, or you can choose to have a negative attitude. I chose the positive. I'm Dave Hummer, and maybe I'll see you around someday.
Houses were neatly rolled onto the wheels of the truck, and the new 40 ladders hung between the sides of the truck. Everything was in